is an HP News Network special report. YouTubers, anti-nuke activists, and Plumegate researchers, welcome to another special report, HP News Network special report. This is your host, Patrick Penry, and I remind you that Plumegate is the silver bullet that will shut down nuclear power and break the back of the conspiracy. So folks, if you haven't read my book yet, Something Wicked This Way Comes, the story of Plumegate, the world's largest provable cover-up, please check out my WordPress blog or my Patrick Penry Unbound website, and you can read it there for free. And soon enough, I'll have it in PDF form where you can download it and read it as a book and go through the pages and mark your page and return to it. I do realize it doesn't have that potential right now, but nevertheless, the information is there. Please go there and read it if you will. Now, what I want to do in this special report is go over some miscellaneous stuff I have in a folder that we need to cover. It's not necessarily directly related to each other, but it's all important and we need to cover this. So let's look at the first screen capture from the Nuclear Regulatory Commission's Freedom of Information Act documents, free and available to the public. These are pertaining to Fukushima and the series of meltdowns in Japan. Here is one from a divine@berkeley.edu. And in this particular email, this is what they say. I'm troubled by the report I just heard on CNN, which indicated that CO, I believe that's cobalt, was in the ocean adjacent to the plant and in the water that burned the three workers. Apparently, the workers were exposed to CO, cobalt-containing water, while in the turbine room. The presence of CO at these two locations suggests that water from the core is releasing into the ocean and into the turbine room. And this is from the 25th of March, and it's going to peterson@nuc.berkeley.edu. I should probably add Berkeley in on this element of the cover-up, because a lot of people in there had a really good idea exactly what was going on. They didn't say anything about it. Okay, at the bottom of this email it says, my concern then was that the chloride would cause stress corrosion. Okay, he's referring to, let me back up a little bit. The salt water. At some point, they begin injecting salt water. Spent fuel pool number 4, reactors, a lot of these, number 1, 2, 3, they injected salt water. Maybe later they put fresh water in, tried to clean it out. There's a lot of discussion about a residue of salt, chemical reactions with salt. This had never been done before. And another group of people was worried about corrosion, that what the salt will cause corrosion. So this is in regards to that salt water causing corrosion when you inject it into these reactors or into the spent fuel pool. It says, the email that I sent to you 1 week ago was prompted by our parking lot discussion in which you mentioned the amount of salt water that was being used to cool the reactors. My concern then was that the chloride would cause stress corrosion cracking of the stainless steel cladding that coats the inside of the reactor pressure vessel and of stainless steel piping that is part of the cooling system. I indicated that an upper limit SCC velocity of about 0.8 centimeters per day in stainless steel exposed to hot aqueous chloride. Hot aqueous chloride would severely corrode and possibly crack low alloy steel and carbon steel, especially if oxygen from air is also present. So this is showing that when you add salt water solution and it's heated, you have the potential to have this corrosion of metals that are critical components to the reactor, the cooling system, or the racks in the spent fuel pool holding the rods. Take your pick. So the adding of salt water is a desperate, you know, you have to understand there's nothing else they could do but try to immediately pump some salt water in there. And it was either that or they contemplated the slurry mixture of sand and bits of lead, and that would have just been to try to hold down as much radiation as they could. Okay, let's look at the next screen capture. This is from Marty Virgilio on April 16th to Eric Leeds. And these are some excellent questions. I thought these were good for us to go over very quickly. We won't answer them, but we will ask them. He says, Eric, my thanks to NRR for the SharePoint site with a Q&A database. There's like a SharePoint site and all these Q&As are going up there for people to draw from if they need them. Again, it's part of the cover-up. That's to select information that they want to allow us to have, the public information in the form of Q&As, press release, talking point, that sort of thing. I would not have survived the congressional hearing had it not been for my review of that information. I believe it should be required reading for anyone who is going to be participating in a public interaction on the events in Japan. So at this circuit, they're going around the NRC to talk about the spent waste problem here in the United States. They're going to be prepared with Q&As for this public interaction. They'll have Q&As on spent fuel pools and waste buildup and all that kind of stuff at these meetings. That's what they do. That said, could you please have the staff review and consider expanding the Q&As in the following areas? Why license renewal reviews do not include a review of the plant's response to external events? Why we should not establish a 50-mile EPZ in the U.S. if this was NRC's recommendation for the accident in Japan? And that's an evacuation zone, emergency protection zone, or whatever you want to call it. Why NRC does not order licensees to move fuel stored in pools to dry casks? Why NRC should not require the more sophisticated, parentheses 3D, seismic studies being voluntarily conducted by licensees in California? How the designs of Mark I containment plants have improved over time? How EPA is monitoring, collecting, and posting information related to the impacts in the U.S. of the accident in Japan? What process we followed in making the 50-mile recommendation in Japan, and what influenced our decision-making? How the process for taking protective measures following an accident, parentheses evacuation, sheltering, potassium iodine, works in the U.S., including the roles and responsibilities of the federal government agencies, states, and locals. And guys, understand that the reason he's prompting these questions is because they want to be able to answer them and not answer them at the same time, if you get what I'm, my drift, okay? Next time he shows up before Congress, if someone asks one of these questions, he wants to already have a Q&A prepared, so he already has a prepared statement, which is evasive, it doesn't give a lot of information, it's nondescript, it's supposed to sound like it answers the question, but it doesn't really answer the question at the same time. That's what these are all about, and that's how they obfuscate the information getting to the American public of the truth about nuclear power. And so if you look at these particular questions, they're good questions, and we'd like really honest, hard-hitting answers, but I'm afraid you're not going to get them. When you look at the talking points, and I've gone over this, they have the public answer and then the non-public answer, too, in some cases, and the two are different. The two are different. One will say there's, I have nothing to worry about, and the other say, hey, there may be a breach of containment and radiation could be released. So what they're willing to give the American public is not a lot. It's not a lot. But what they know themselves on the inside and that you can glean out of these documents is quite a bit more. And if you watched my video earlier, special report on the non-seismically qualified spent fuel pools, and the Nureg manual that says the spent fuel pools are seismically robust, you can really catch them in, a lie, because something doesn't add up there. It's easy to find if you go through these documents and then examine their public statements. The two don't always ring true. Okay, next screen cap. This is from Fred Lyon on April 19. Sent a couple of people there from the NRC, and he says, for your information, attaches a copy of the presentation on Three Mile Island and Fukushima that Lake Barrett will present to the National Academies of Sciences today. Again, this is April 19th. You've had some time elapse, and people are beginning to give these presentations. The first part of the presentation is Three Mile Island. The Fukushima pictures start on slide 15. The video of the tsunami cresting the turbine building roof is not functional in the attachment, so I've sent it separately. Okay, and at the bottom, says Lake's presentation is based on publicly available information and will be available to the public. So I don't know if that video of the tsunami cresting the turbine building, if you guys have seen that. I've never seen it. I've never heard about it until I read this email. I've got another one where they admit that TEPCO measured a watermark on Unit 2, on Building 2, at 46 feet. At 46 feet height. So here's another evidence of a tsunami cresting the turbine building. I can't see the video, but we know they're talking about a video that shows that visibly, which is pretty incredible and probably something they want to downplay and suppress. They don't want you to know the wave height was 46 foot on Building 2. You translate that to some of our plants on the coast, and this certainly cannot withstand a 46-foot tall wave. I think San Onofre went to 30 feet or something like that. I have to go back and look, but I don't think any of them are prepared for a tsunami or an earthquake of that magnitude. So now we have evidence of, you know, they're not ready for a tsunami, they're not seismically qualified spent fuel pools, so on and so forth. So we're really in a bad situation right now in the United States. Okay, next email from Michael Weber, April 22nd. Query, potential complication of contaminated debris. I am referring a question to you that I suggest you ask the Protective Measures Team rep to pursue with EPA and DOE representatives. And I underline that because I want you to know EPA and DOE are very tightly knit and closely involved in this cover-up. This is not a priority and can be worked over the next week. Given the list of assessments that are currently in the queue, their near-term schedules, and heavy reliance on radiation protection specialists, I expect that your Protective Measures Team rep has higher priorities today. Okay, here's the important part. Yesterday, we received two new Congressional Research Service reports. One of them was titled Effects of Radiation from Fukushima Daiichi on the U.S. Marine Environment. The report notes that, based on computer modeling of ocean currents, debris from the tsunami caused by the Tohoku earthquake is projected to spread eastward from Japan in the North Pacific subtropical gyre. Consistent with these projections, the debris plume is expected to reach the United States west coast in about 3 years, including beaches in California and Alaska. Because this debris was off the eastern coast of Japan at the time that the largest atmospheric releases occurred from the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power station in mid-March 2011, it is possible that this floating debris is contaminated with iodine-131, cesium-134, and cesium-137 from atmospheric fallout and rainout. The iodine should be long gone by the time that the debris begins washing up on the U.S. coast, but there could still be elevated concentrations of radioactive cesium on the debris, with half-lives of 2 and 30 years, respectively. Is EPA assessing the potential for U.S. exposure to radiation from this vector? It may be prudent for DOE to conduct an AMS overflight of the debris field now, before it becomes more dispersed, to assess the potential extent of contamination of this debris. Such information could be used as the starting point for assessing the likelihood and public health and environment significance of contaminated debris washing up on the U.S. coast. Based on the results of the assessment, the U.S. may need to plan precautions and protective measures. This is huge, really huge. Have you heard a lot about this? Not at least of the debris that's going to arrive 3 years later. I heard that they sunk some debris, the Navy did, or something to that effect. But at least as of April 22, they're seriously considering this massive debris field and its potential to be radioactive. And I put a note under the screen cap. What about plutonium? They never mentioned plutonium. MOX fuel. I just got a screen cap the other day where the Canadians are concerned that we need to adjust our source term, in other words, the radiation source in our modeling, because they say we're not accounting for the MOX fuel. They say, what about the MOX fuel in the number 3 reactor? You need to adjust your source term. So I found another instance where they discuss MOX fuel, which is plutonium-laden mixed oxide fuel. I also have a screen capture. I'll try to include it in this one again as well, where the Japanese say they're having trouble accessing the Fukushima Daiichi facility because of MOX sludge. Radioactive MOX sludge is causing access problems. Okay, so here's that debris field contaminated with plutonium, cesium, strontium, so on and so forth. 3 years, that'd be 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014, that major gyre and debris field is expected to wash up on beaches on the West Coast. Okay, and I think this is the last screen cap we're going to look at in these group of miscellaneous that I wanted to cover. And this is from March 11 at 12:17 p.m., same day as the massive earthquake and tsunami that caused the meltdowns in Japan. Okay, let's have a look at the first email from 11:15 a.m., March 11th, from Scott Burnell to a number of people. Subject, rumor control. And I'll explain what this means in a second because I had to ask about it myself. I knew it was something important but didn't know what it was. It says, all. Elliot just took a call from Platts asking about Japanese quote-unquote utility execs at headquarters responding to the quake. The reporter said another Platts reporter had heard quote-unquote from the regions, maybe the regions 1, 2, 3, or 4, that this was the case. While Elliott told Platts, "We are allowing Japanese regulators," in big letters, block letters, "to use our communications facilities as a courtesy," the bottom line is that this topic is off limits for now. Refer any further questions on this to HQ. Thanks, Scott. And here's another one that says, Elaine Hiro, probably not saying that, pronouncing that right, "New Japanese industry is in town for RIC. This was some kind of meeting that the NPP licensees and stakeholders were already here in regards to. But I didn't tell her that they were at our building. Maybe they connected the dots." Okay, now what does this mean, and why is this topic off limits? It sounds pretty serious. Why are they rephrasing the person and saying they're regulators, not utility execs? Well, here's the deal. This is the same day as the accident, and this email right here proves that on that same day, the NRC had at their facility, quote-unquote, utility execs, people from Japan who could translate, who could speak English, who could speak Japanese, and they were at the NRC facility, and they were able to respond along with NRC to the crisis as it was ongoing at that time. So the NRC early on, had translators, had connections, had people from Japan, from the nuclear industry. They were already here, and they were already connected with each other at that time. So there's no excuse they can say, well, we couldn't translate, we didn't understand, we couldn't communicate that well. Hey, they had great communication from day one with the Japanese. Translators, everything you need to understand what's going on in real time. Okay, and, well, nope, got one more. Let's check this one out real quick. And this is from some kind of committee, RST06 Hawk, to a number of people there, including the infamous Kathy Gibson. Request for Ops Center RTS support. Here's the important part we'll read out at the bottom. So the objective for the second question is to support multiple questions/actions. There have been many requests of the protective measures team for quote-unquote realistic dose models. And that's not that indicative of anything in and of itself, because they'll have a worst case, a least worst case, a realistic worst case. It's kind of the way, I don't say it's right the way to do that. There's only one worst case, but in this instance, they're looking for realistic dose models. Not that indicative of anything there, but check it out where it goes from there. The reactor safety team assessment document also contains recommended actions for the Japanese to consider. These recommendations are based on the severe accident management guidelines, which all are intended to protect primary containment. Since primary containment is damaged on at least two units, we need to assess whether there may be new considerations/priorities that are not captured by these severe accident management guidelines. Again, this is important because I've seen this before where someone says, and I've got a letter from somebody where they say, considering it was multiple containment breaches and your guidelines only deal with a single accident and one breach of containment of one reactor, shouldn't we look into what are we going to do if there's multiples at the same time? And this guy is essentially asking the same question. It's a relevant question. It's a logical question. It's one that we need to have answered. And they don't have a procedure for that. They don't have a procedure when a 46-foot-tall tsunami sweeps over your equipment following a 8.9 massive earthquake. They really don't. There's no known procedure to handle that. You just got to rig some pumps in there and hose it with salt water and hope for the best, folks. And that's where we're at. Okay, this is your host, Patrick Penry, and this ends another HP News Network special report. Hope you learned something. You guys have an excellent day. Over. This has been an HP News Network special report.
We need to get subscribed and get this unity stronger and beat YouTube at their own game. Okay, that's what this is about. Like I say, go to the remix button, hit the remix button. That way you'll have this video and keep up with this. Otherwise, YouTube's just going to control us, guys, and it's really bad.